Road to Calvary. Tried by sinful men.
Sins away that bring us nigh unto the shore, the rock. Our hope
is Jesus, hope is saved. Hallelujah, now and ever we confess. Christ, our hope and life.
To the grave, what shall we sing? Christ, he lives, Christ, he lives, and what reward will heaven bring? Everlasting life with him, there we will rise to meet the Lord, then sin and death will be destroyed, and we will
Amen. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
That's good. Good start to our morning this morning. If you're visiting with us, let me say a special word of welcome to you. So glad that you are here visiting with us this morning. You could do me a favor in the pew back in front of you. There is a card that looks like this. If you just take that out and fill it out, we'd just love to know that you're here. Not going to pester or bother you. Just love to drop you a line in the mail and thanking you for being with us this morning. If you'd like to learn more about the church, there's a little trifold pamphlet on the back table. You can grab it. It'll just to tell you a little bit more about who we are here at Parish Church, and just want to welcome you here this morning. We do have just a few announcements before we get started this morning. The first of it is just to thank you for last week's ministry mobilization meeting that we had last week. As y'all stayed after, we ate together. The kids had a blast playing outside, and we were able to kind of share with you a little bit about what the Lord has been doing here at Parish Church and where we believe He's taking us. And so was excited to hear a lot of the feedback from y'all, just excited to hear place, you know, just knowing where you can begin fitting in and connecting in ministry, serving here at the church and outside. And so I do want to remind you a few things from last week's meeting, just so we're all on the same page this week. As you remember, last week we told you there's some small ministry cards, ministry commitment cards that we asked y'all to fill out, think about. You could take them home with you. You could just pray and think this week and come back this week prepared to just think through places in the church where you might want to serve, engage the ministry. Those cards are in the back little fellowship area off to your left. We've set a table there. All the kind of explanations of all the ministries and things that were presented last week are on that table. You can take those. If you have more questions or want to know more about those ministries, those are there for you. You can talk to myself or Alex Sprague up here. Any of our ministry leaders that presented last week, they'd all love to share with you and talk with you about that. On the back table, there's a list of our ministry leaders and chairs, and you can take that. It's got contact numbers, emails for them. You can contact them by email or phone call. They're happy to answer any of your questions. If you're not prepared to fill out a card today, take one with you. Continue to pray and think. We're going to leave that open for the next couple of weeks for y'all to continue to pray about places that you can begin serving. If you're looking for some just immediate practical needs that you can begin filling, a couple of things are just coming on quick that we're going to need people's help for. The youth, they meet on Sunday evenings, and there's meals that are provided for our youth. The people of the church have been providing those for the past couple of years. We've been very grateful for that. Generally, the parents of our youth are providing that, and then others that have just volunteered along the way. So if you would like to help provide meals for the youth on Sunday evenings, Evan could use your help today, so you could see him. That would be very helpful. You don't have to like check the youth ministry as a place you're going to serve. You can just kind of talk to him about getting information about how to sign up for that. Also, our 9 to 12-year-old Sunday program that we're going to start up this kind of fall for our 9 to 12-year-olds on Sunday afternoons and evenings, we need people to volunteer for that, people who want to commit to kind of heading that ministry up. And so if you're interested in that, please let Lauren know as soon as possible. You can fill out a ministry card for that, and that would help us. So those are just some immediate places where you can serve. Two other things that I want to mention about last week's meeting, just to remind us. Many of y'all had some questions about the Mercy Ministry portion of our meeting. There was a lot of information that came through that. There's been a lot of energy given to thinking through how we begin to moving forward as a church in Mercy and moving out from the church into the community. And so I want to just kind of summarize some things because some of y'all had several questions. I just wanted to kind of tell you kind of in super summary form what the gist of some of that was last week. Alec and David and Kevin and the deacons have been working hard on that. And so I just wanted to give you just a brief kind of a few things that you can think about and continue praying for. Three basic things that Mercy's focused on: partnerships within the community. We're looking for places in the community where the Lord's already at work so that we can come alongside and love and serve in those places. We already have some relationships with Escape from Poverty. They've come to share on a Sunday morning from us. Kevin's been on the board there and have served there, and so we've got relationship with them. The Bridge Ministry that meets just down the road from here, Claudie. St. Louis is the executive director there now of that ministry, and so a lot of inroads and opportunities to serve there. And then the Hub Ministry meets just down the road at the church off to the left. It's actually where we were having some of our early informational meetings when we started the church in that building. They're now occupying that space. They use our parking lot on Tuesday nights and Wednesday mornings. We've been in conversations with them about ways that we can love and serve them. So partnerships already and what's already going on in the community is important to us. We're also looking for those of you who have ideas and kind of want to spearhead some entrepreneurial kind of ideas about how to meet needs in our community. All of that's under partnerships. The second big kind of endeavor that we're looking into is a food pantry, providing immediate resources to people with immediate needs. There's going to be more information to come on that over the next couple of weeks as we're kind of continuing to organize that. One of the things we're trying to do is streamline the process on how you can buy items and contribute to the food pantry. We're going to try to do that through an Amazon kind of church Amazon kind of shopping list that you can just click on through a link that we provide. You can just purchase the items. They'll get shipped directly here to the church, and that's a way that you can easily contribute to the food pantry. And they're working on how to think through the tiers of help we want to offer people, folks with immediate kind of simple needs all the way to more complex needs. How do we think through that? They're working through that now, but we're going to begin kind of taking items in really soon on that, and so we'll be getting you information on that. And then the third thing was just shepherding care as a whole. How do we begin thinking about how to kind of care in a shepherding way towards the needs both in our body and in the community around us? Two ways that we communicated that last week were through case managers, really just individuals who are willing to come alongside individuals and families that are going through difficult times and seasons in their lives, just to love, serve them, to assess their need and help them walk through a process of moving from need back to a place of flourishing. And so we're working through that process. They have the shell of that already ready to go. It's just a matter of working now with the Mercy team that's going to come alongside the diaconate and help kind of work through the pieces of that as they go forward. And they're looking to do that over the next month and a half or so. The one question that was asked about that last week is, if you're on the Mercy ministry team, are you already a case manager? And the answer to that's no. You don't have to be a case manager if you want to serve in Mercy, but it is a primary focus of the Mercy ministry. And so asking you to be prayerfully considering what it means what it might mean for you to serve in that capacity. Also, lastly on that is that the deacons are going to be serving as primary kind of overseers of that. And so you're not going to be kind of thrown to the wolves on those things. As you care for individuals, you're going to have a resource, a deacon right behind you, encouraging you, facilitating, resourcing you in every way that they can. And then the second part of that shepherding care comes through our Mercy Fund. Monies that we're going to take up as a church. We're going to build a pool of resource money to where when we need to meet tangible needs in our body and outside, that there is a pool of resource that we can offer them. We're beginning to take money for that right now. You heard that, you saw in the newsletter this week, a link that you can click on to give to our Mercy Fund. We're asking that if you're going to give to the Mercy Fund, please make sure that that's above and beyond your commitment to give to the church, your regular tithes. That is an above and beyond your tithe, regular giving. Church has still got a function to move forward. But how can we begin to give to those in need as well on top of that? So there's a number of ways you can do that. It's going to be in a link in our newsletter. You can go, if some of y'all are already giving through our Tithely app, there's a drop-down tab for you to do that. So you can just click there, and it'll say Mercy Fund. You can click on that and give to that directly. Or you can just fill out one of the envelopes in the back, stick a check in there, and make sure you put on the front of that envelope it's for Mercy Fund. Okay? We'd love to answer any more questions you have about that. And that Mercy component is a major one for us as we go forward as a church. And I know Alec and David, Kevin, and our deacons would love to talk with you about any of the questions you might have with all of that. I will be happy to talk with you too, and my conversation will be, that's a great question. Alec and David know the answer. So please come talk to me so I can tell you that. So yes, please see them. That'd be awesome. Last thing I want to say is our D group ministries that we mentioned last week. It's our small group discipleship groups, right? Three or four gender-related kind of groups, male groups and female groups that break up. There's three or four in a group, and they meet every other week, kind of working through a series of studies that we go through over the course of a year. If you're interested in being a part of a D group and have not done that yet, the sign-up sheet's on the same table with all the other papers back there in the fellowship hall. Go ahead and sign up for a D group. As soon as you can, would love to start kind of pitting this together. It's really just whoever we get signed up, as soon as we get the critical mass we need for a group, we're going to launch that group. So if you're interested in being part of our D groups, please sign up in the back. And if you have any questions about D groups, you can see me. I can help you think through that any way you need to know. Okay? All right. That's all of our announcements this morning. We're here to worship the living God. And what a joy it is to gather as God's people to do so. We're working through a series right now called Biblical Manhood and Womanhood in our sermon series. It's 3 weeks on biblical manhood and womanhood. Today we're looking at biblical manhood. And as I think about the call to worship this morning from Revelation 19 and 22, we think about when the Lord calls us home and when he communicates to us his love and grace to us, he does so in the relationship of man and wife. The bride and the bridegroom, and you can hear his invitation this morning when he says, come to the bridegroom who lavishes you with his love. That's his invitation for us this morning as we meet to worship him. And so I want to pray for us, set our time aside, and then ask the Lord to invite us into worship as we read the call to worship. Let's pray together. Our great God and Father, what a joy it is to gather as God's people here today. Lord, life is so busy, it's chaotic, it's full of so many responsibilities and challenges, sorrows and joys, weights of this world, internal struggles of sin, external struggles with just the practical realities of rent and mortgage and grocery bills and light bills and all the just challenging dynamics that we face week in and week out. The weight of responsibility of competing in the marketplace and reality of trying to have the energy to love and serve at home in the way that we need to, the way you've called us to. Lord, all of life's responsibilities pile up on us. And you give us one day in seven to find our rest again in you. Not just because of the weight of sin and the struggle of sin in this world. Lord, before sin even entered the world, you said it is good for us to pause and to reflect and to celebrate all that you are and all that you do for us. And so if there were no conflicts, no struggle, no turmoil in our lives, Lord, it would be good for us to pause, to gather, to sing, and to celebrate today. But all the more because of sin. We come with those not just with the opportunity to worship, but those in desperate need of worship. So, Lord, this morning we ask that you would meet us here, that you would tune our hearts to sing your praise, as the psalm writer tells us. You would meet us where we are this morning, but you would not leave us there. You'd carry us a little further down the road where you'd have us be, that you would lift high the Lord Jesus in our hearts. And that you would cultivate in us a deeper love, a deeper affection for you in and through the work of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, this morning, and in whose name we pray. Amen. Would you stand this morning as his word calls us to worship? I love his invitation this morning, his expression of worship to us as we look at it in Revelation. Hear God's word, Revelation 19, 6 through 8, 22, 17. Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, "Hallelujah! For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. And the Spirit and the bride, they say, come. And let the one who hears say, come. And let the one who is thirsty come. And let the one who desires take the water of life without price." This morning, let's worship our living God as we sing together, "Behold Our God."
God, he who has felt the nails upon his hands, who's borne all the guilt of sinful man, God eternal, humble to the grave, Jesus Savior, risen now to reign. That is why we can come and confess our sins as a body of believers here this morning, is because of what Christ has done. As he gave himself willingly upon the cross, no one took his life, he laid it down willingly for you and I, and it is not his will that any of you, his children, should live in fear and guilt and shame. And that's what sin does to us, and we so often just carry it around with us needlessly. So join with me now as we confess our sin together from passage in 1 John chapter 1. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. Let us pray. Lord, as we think about you going to the cross, humbling yourself to the grave, having your hands and feet pierced, being beaten beyond recognition, marred so that you did not even look like a man. We are humbled, Lord, and our hearts are melted, and we come before you as your dear children, confessing all of our sinful thoughts and deeds, our words, our actions, our behavior. Lord, the things that we're ashamed to admit, that we keep secret from everyone else, you already know them. And it is not your will that we should live with them and bear the burden of them when you already have. Father, help us now to, as we enumerate our sins before you silently, help us to lay them at your feet and to receive the cleansing blood of your Son. And please take a few moments now to lay your sins before the Lord and confess them to him. Lord, it would take all day for us to enumerate our sins if you would reveal them all to us. We pray for sensitive hearts that we could see if there's any wicked way in us, that you would lead us into your life everlasting. Remind us that it is not your will to for us to languish in sin and shame and brokenness, but to come before you and be freed from it and renewed and refreshed again and again by the cleansing blood of your Son. And it's in his name that we pray this morning. Amen. And our assurance of forgiveness also comes from 1 John chapter 5. It says, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the confidence that we have toward him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the requests that we have asked of him. Join with us as we continue in worship and sing.
Amazing love, how can it
omniscient, all-knowing, he counts not their sum, thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. What patience would wait as we constantly roam. What Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many. Of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath a debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
Please have all of the children to the front. I know there's a lot of you today. Good morning. How are you, Parker?
Good.
Good. We have quite the crew this morning. Boys, come in a little closer. Come on, Elliot. Well, good morning. Okay, so have any of you guys ever done anything foolish? No. I have. I'll be the first to admit I've done something foolish. I'm going to tell you a story. Understand, this was 9 years ago. I've matured a lot, okay? A lot. My husband does not know I'm telling this story, but I did something very, very foolish. So 9 years ago, when me and my husband were dating, he had a rule. I was not allowed to drive his car because I didn't have a license. That's a good rule, right? You shouldn't drive a car if you don't have a license, right? That's dangerous. It's dangerous, right? Now, I knew how to drive, but I should not have driven because I didn't have a license. And he told me this, Lauren, you're not allowed to drive my car. Well, one day, I was hungry, and I borrowed his car without permission. Now, I didn't drive the car. I had a friend who had a license drive the car, but I still didn't have his permission to take his car. That was wrong of me, right? And when he found out, how do you think he reacted? I should have gone to church after that. Yeah. How do you think he reacted after he found out that I borrowed his car? Yeah, he was really mad. Even more so than mad, though, he was really disappointed in me. really disappointed. I'll never forget the look on his face. He was so disappointed in me.
And yeah, he wasn't disappointed because, like, actually, like, he didn't have permission.
Right, I didn't have permission. I didn't have permission. Now, I didn't drive, so I didn't technically break the law, but I didn't have his permission, and he was really, really disappointed in me. And when I saw his face, I knew that I never wanted him to be disappointed in me again. That's actually the day that I knew that I loved him, because I never wanted to see that face again of him being disappointed in me. So what do you think I did after I returned the car? What did I have to do to restore my relationship with him? I had to say sorry. I had to apologize, and I had to ask for his forgiveness, right? Today, you are going to learn about the people in Jerusalem having to ask forgiveness from God. So after Nehemiah has built the walls around Jerusalem, it's been about 70 years that they've been in exile, and they are not living the way that God has called them to live. And Ezra is commanded by God to go and share with them the law. And so Ezra shares with them the law, and they become really sad because they realize they're not living the way that they're supposed to. They realize they're letting God down. And so the people of Jerusalem have to repent, and they have to apologize and restore their relationship with God. Just like I had to repent and restore my relationship with my boyfriend at the time, my husband now. All right? So when you are in Children's Church today, I want you to be listening to Miss Lisa as she teaches the lesson. Listen to how the people realized that they were wrong, realized that they were sinning against God, and their hearts were sad and convicted, and they knew they had to apologize and repent to God. All right, can you guys do that when you're in the lesson today? She's got a fun craft for you, too, to demonstrate this. All right, let's go ahead and pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for these children. I thank you that you are a God of forgiveness. You are a God who desires that we have restored relationship with you. Father, I pray that as these children sit in the children's church and learn their lesson, Father, that you'll be speaking to their hearts about what that looks like in their own lives. God, we just thank you for them, and we pray that you will bless our time this morning, whether they are in children's church or in the sermon. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, guys, you can go back with your parents, or you can go line up in the back.
All right, our children are dismissed to children's church. They can make their way to the back. Mr. Jeremy and company are back there. If you'll head back to the door. If you want your children to stay with you in the service, make sure you grab them on the way out, as they will follow the crowd. While they're making their way out, you can turn with me this morning to Genesis chapter 2. I want to thank you all for being patient with us this morning. We had some technical difficulty with our projector, and so y'all are working from song sheets and worship guides this morning. We're going to have readings from two different passages, and so you'll actually have to, thankfully it's just two different pages of the Bible, so you just flip over to the next one. But we'll be in Genesis chapter 2 and Genesis chapter 3. As we consider the topic this morning, biblical manhood. A couple of things I want to say on the front end before we read. I just want to just kind of remind you what we're doing right now. Our sermon series is biblical manhood and womanhood. We started last week with an introduction, kind of a foundation introduction to that message, to this kind of series last week. And so this week and next week, this week we'll be dealing with biblical manhood, and then next week we'll be dealing with biblical womanhood. So I want to say a couple of things about that on the beginning, on the front end, is that these are large topics, right, that a lot of ink has been spilt over, whole councils have been developed over, all kinds of most sermons that we do here are strictly exegetical sermons. We look to the text and we just walk through and explain it. Today we're looking at 2, 15 to 25, 3, 16 to 19 in a general way, but my intention is not to explain the text, but to use it in a sense as a backdrop of an overarching kind of theological doctrine of manhood throughout the scriptures, right? It's a launching point in terms. It's not our normal practice, but it is a foundation upon which you can build an understanding of it throughout the scriptures, and this backdrop will inform everything we're saying along the way. So just wanted you to know that it's a little bit different than what we normally do, but for the sake of understanding the Bible's teaching on biblical manhood, we'll be looking throughout the scriptures for that. So here's the question. What is a man? What is manhood? What is manliness? Some of y'all have seen the documentary that's come out recently on the Daily Wire, right? What is a woman? A lot of you have seen or watched that or have heard things about that. They go around asking, how would you define a woman? And if we were to do the same thing and ask you, how do you define what a man is? What are the things that you would say? Just think about them in your own head for a minute. What does it mean to be a man distinctly? What is manliness? Well, I was kind of curious as I began the study this week, began looking at some just kind of broad searches on the great purveyor of knowledge, Google, and just kind of wanted to see what is out there. What would they describe as manly? I just decided to look up top 10 things that you would describe that would describe manliness. I got a ton of feedback on it, so I was just kind of curious reading through it. It's interesting to me that magazines that are well known for being very kind of culturally relevant that would talk about gender fluidity and all kinds of things had some really, really funny kind of stereotypical masculine things of all kinds of just craziness that went along the way. I could have chosen from any number of these kind of top 10 things, but I decided to behave myself and kind of stick with a more conservative top 10 list. Maybe to frame our conversation a little bit today, if we were to ask the question, what would you say? Well, here's what this rather conservative article says. A true man shows that he values women by the way he respects and loves the special ladies in his life, namely his mother, sister, and girlfriend or wife. 2, he won't hesitate to investigate your car troubles while you shine a flashlight and provide moral support. He is your knight in shining armor and personal handyman, rescuing you from automobile inconveniences and saving you money at the mechanic level, even if he tells you not to drive the car and you still do. 3, sorry Lauren, that was for you. 3, he knows how to use a gun and defend you at times of crisis. Ugh, right? 4, he cries only on 3 occasions. When his dog dies, when he hears God Bless the USA by Lee Greenwood, and when his team wins the Super Bowl or national championship, if it pertains to you, if you prefer NCAA over NFL. So as you may know, I have cried a lot over the past decade. Sorry, that was subtle. Sorry, Alabama fan up here. All right, moving on. I've lost most of you at this point. 5, he is a chivalrous gentleman who hoists your luggage into the overhead compartment of a plane, carries your shopping bags, and physically opens every door for you. Sure, you're perfectly capable of doing it yourself, but you're a princess to him. 6, it brings him sheer joy to gallivant around a hardware store. He can't wait to go to Home Depot and make a beeline for the lumber to pick out some fresh 2x4s, which he lamentingly discovers are more expensive this year. Thank you, Biden. That's just in there. I didn't put that. That's not political commentary. 7, he drinks brown liquor, smokes fine cigars. He's well-versed in bourbons and scotch and isn't interested in wine, which means you have plenty left for your girls' night in, ladies. A couple of y'all are offended by that one. It's 8. He goes all out for the 4th of July. I'm talking about fireworks, barbecue, a killer playlist, and a star-spangled Hawaiian shirt. You know you have one. 9. The military wouldn't deem him unfit to serve if ever we went to war again. He'd make a fine soldier and look fine in uniform, unlike most young American dudes today. 10 and final. He opts for cowboy boots and flannel, not tie-dye and Birkenstocks. Sorry to those of you who are still living in the 60s. You kind of get the idea, right? This kind of understanding of how we think through and define masculinity. What are the categories that begin to define the way we think about it? Oftentimes, it's very external in its nature. It's very physiological in nature. Oftentimes, it has to do with kind of major distinctions in how we do things. And oftentimes, when we talk through them, they descend and just conversation and language that doesn't feel expressly biblical, just different. Contrasting, as it were, to women. We got a lot of ways that we talk about it. But how do we think through it as the church? How do we as men and women of God think through what does it mean to be a biblical man? What does it mean to be a biblical woman amidst all the noise that begins to define those terms? I told you I wasn't going to talk about a lot of what this list of 10 talks about today, right? Particular roles or particular kind of physiological distinctions that mark those. Those are the things you might actually want to hear me talk about. Get into the details. Help me think through those kind of external details, because that's oftentimes where the conversation descends. But we need to pull back and consider something more foundationally biblical about what it means to be a biblical man. I want to do so in a few ways this morning. I'm borrowing these kind of headings, although I define it very differently. I just want to quote the source so you don't think I made up my own P's this morning. But there's three P's that I heard from another writer that kind of mark or set apart this discussion for us this morning on biblical manhood. Patterns, principles, and practices of a godly man. Patterns, principles, and practices of a godly man. So let's begin thinking about patterns, because if you just want to look up and say, here's the passage that gives top 10 things of what a biblical man looks like, you're not going to find it. We have to look at those patterns and principles that the scriptures set before us to be able to draw from them certain practices that will look distinct in many of our different homes and contexts. So what are those patterns of biblical manhood first and foremost? There are 2 points that I want to kind of discuss under this. When we start thinking of patterns of biblical manhood, when we start thinking of what terms become synonymous with biblical manhood, we would use words like leadership and authority. That's kind of the default words that are often used in discussions today about biblical manhood, leadership, authority. Let's start with this first word, leadership. When we talk about the pattern of biblical leadership in the scriptures, how do we begin to understand it as it relates to biblical manhood? Well, if we started in the Old Testament, we could begin mapping that out a little bit, right? We started with Adam, kind of looking at a pattern, a biblical pattern of leadership. In Adam, we would find a representative. Adam's very much a representative of the whole of the human race. His leadership is serving as a representative to the rest of the rest of creation. Adam was the one held accountable for the whole of human race and the subsequent consequences of sin. Like this thing's hitting me over here and popping. There we go. So, we read Romans 5, 12 through 14. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man and death through sin, so death spread to all men because all sinned. For sin indeed was in the world before the law was given, but sin is counted where there is no law. Yet death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sinning was not like the transgression of Adam, who was a type of the one who was to come. Adam was a representative of us. And so when we think about leadership, he represents our leadership to us at the very beginning. That story of leadership is one of failure. Adam's representative leadership over the people was marked by failure and dysfunction. From his failures and representative leadership come the fall of man, the murder of a sibling, the wiping out of all but one family on the earth, and the flood because of mankind's utter wickedness, and the division of all civilization at Babel in order to guard it from self-destruction. This representative didn't represent us very well. Then if you move forward in the narrative, you get to Abraham, the father of many nations, the great patriarch of the people of God. Yet in his leadership, Abraham struggled with his faith, the leadership of his wife, and the fear of man. Maybe we fast forward to Jacob. Jacob's a prominent figure in the Old Testament, was the great patriarch of the 12 tribes of Israel. He was himself renamed Israel to represent God's love and affection set upon the people of Israel. Jacob was a scared, timid, and very conflicted man in the story. There's all kinds of chaos in his marital situation, which comes about as a result of his fleeing from his eldest brother, whose birthright he stole in order to be considered the first among the siblings. He was far from the ideal patriarch. Then you have Moses, the great lawgiver, leader of God's people into the promised land. He was fearful, insecure, hot-headed, and ultimately denied access to the promised land because of his disobedience. The great Old Testament mediator. David, the man after God's own heart, the great king over Israel, the precursor to the messianic hope of the great king to come. David, as we know, was an adulterer, a murderer, whose kids would wreak havoc upon the kingdom. The Old Testament leaves us with a messy picture of biblical manhood. And in fact, the story of the Bible, right, is this kind of creation narrative met with the fall of mankind, and then this great longing every step of the way from that day forward for a greater patriarch than Abraham, right? A greater representative than Adam, a greater patriarch than Abraham, a greater mediator than Moses, a greater king than David. Everything is pointing us again and again to where we fell. There is one who is coming, who comes to fulfill all things. The story of the Old Testament is one of a struggle and failure amidst God's faithfulness to hold us as his people so that we can fast forward to the place where Christ comes in. There's a messy picture of biblical manhood. The women who stand behind these men played vital roles and contributions to the narrative in a similar way. Strengths and weaknesses, successes and failure mark much of the story, both men and women of the Old Testament, and we are left with a tenuous story of biblical manhood and womanhood. Nonetheless, the regular expression of those in positions of leadership in the Old Testament were men, with a few irregular exceptions. However, we are left wanting when it comes to a clear definition and expression of that biblical manhood, that biblical leadership that they provide in these Old Testament figures. We're simply left longing for a better hope, a better picture of what it looks like, what it means. Enters Christ. That which everything is pushing us to, that's constantly, as you read the story of the Old Testament, you felt what the people felt. When is he coming? When is the promised hope coming? We are helpless and hopeless. We keep dropping the ball here again and again. Where is the one who clarifies our picture? Enters Christ, who gives us an example of leadership in a number of ways. A few ways that Christ exemplified this biblical view of leadership that is marked oftentimes by biblical manhood. The first thing is he pushed against cultural norms. He pushed against cultural norms. He spoke with and cared for and stopped whole crowds to address and allowed women into his inner circle. He respected and valued women in his day. The extent to which this countercultural and scandal... The extent to which this was countercultural and scandalous is really actually hard to understate. When Jesus stopped and spoke to the woman at the well and validated her to the extent that he did, it was shocking to her and scandalous even to his own disciples, who you think would have been used to it at that point. When he taught on divorce, he talked about the equal rights and requirements of men and women in the marriage relationship, where the culture would have addressed women as property of the men. He's addressing divorce in this mutual responsibility language. Scandalous, fundamentally different. He ministered to countless women, valuing them on par with men. He used illustrations exalting women for their spiritual example. The poor widow's offering, the persistent widow, the woman in search of the lost coin. All of these in the day, scandalous. Jesus even received the ministry of women through their anointing of him, their service to him, their providing for the ministry out of their own means. It was the women who were first at the tomb checking on Jesus, who were the first to report his resurrection to the church. He pushed against cultural norms by respecting and valuing women and also teaching women. There are many women who traveled with Jesus' inner circle and sat at Jesus' feet, even at the expense of service to Jesus, even when they could have, should have, when culturally should have been serving Jesus. He exalted Mary for sitting under his teaching over against being busy at work serving him, as Martha was doing. That's outlandish. You don't know that. We don't live in that time. Outlandish for its time. It's hard to quantify the scandalous nature of his actions there. Where this may not be seen as such a big deal for us today, it was remarkably abnormal for the time. Women were not encouraged to be educated, nor were they even thought capable of education. Women, what education they did receive was primarily focused on their domestic duties. He respected and taught women. Third, he fought against false religious paradigms. Jesus didn't just push back against cultural norms that devalued women. He also pushed back against the religious establishment's view of authority and race. In the parable of the Good Samaritan, the society referred to these Samaritans as dogs. And instead of referring to them as such, he elevated these dogs to the status of model of Christian love and mercy. These individuals that in that day and time would have been considered dogs who didn't deserve to eat from the table of the Jewish people, he elevated to the position, to the example of love and mercy over against the religious leaders who were a part of the story, the most coveted of the people of that day. In the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector, it was the hated tax collector who humbled himself before God and was elevated or lifted above the religious leader. The religious leader's so-called piety. Again and again, Jesus pushed against cultural norms of authority, gender, race, as they were presented in the culture of his day. He pushed against cultural norms is the first thing. The second thing that we see about Jesus is that he worked tirelessly. He worked tirelessly. Jesus modeled tireless service. If Jesus is to be held up as the ideal man, then we find in his example a tireless pursuit of the work and will of God. He was diligent to pray, to serve, to share the good news, to hear the concerns and complaints of friends and followers. He gave his life away for the good of others. He modeled tireless service. He sought success in the kingdom, not in the world. Jesus warned against the dangers of being lost in the pursuit of this world and its wealth, as seen in the story of the rich young ruler. He talked about the dangers of gaining the whole world and wealth and power and possessions at the expense of your own soul. He preached a message of daily dying to one's own desires and ambitions and goals for the sake of following Jesus above all else in your life. Manhood was expressed, it was marked most by how you follow the master, not how you lead the masses. He stood against cultural norms. He worked tirelessly. And third, Christ bucked worldly standards. He bucked worldly standards. He didn't consider external stereotypes the thing that defined his role as a godly man. He didn't follow external stereotypes that we might find, flannel shirts and cowboy boots, as good as they may be. I almost wore one today just so I could say, huh. But that wasn't the point of the purpose. Does that mean take off your flannel and take off your cowboy? No, wear those things with pride. Enjoy it. Just don't think it makes you distinctly man, right? He pushed against external stereotypes. Isaiah 53:2-3. For he grew up, speaking of the Messiah to come, he grew up before them, like a young plant, like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look on him, no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, as one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised and we esteemed him not. It wasn't about his external appearance. Wasn't primarily those things. Look, health is great, exercise great, working out and being fit is all excellent. It is not the primary expression of manliness, however good and right and healthy it may be. He also stood against role stereotypes. Luke 22:24-26. A dispute also arose among them as to which of them was to be regarded as the greatest. And Jesus said to them, the kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors, but not so with you. Rather, Let the greatest among you become the youngest or the least, and the leader as one who serves. Cultural stereotype is lead, put people underneath. He says, no, let the greatest among you be the least. Let those who would be Lord serve. He's turning stereotypical roles of leadership on its head. He starts thinking of first and foremost about this idea, these patterns of biblical manhood by way of leadership. We've got to redefine some terms. But what about this word authority, the second aspect of things that we think of when we think of patterns of authority in the Bible? This word authority comes up again and again. If we are going to talk about the word authority when it comes to biblical manhood, we're going to have to speak about the word head, headship, correct? It's a term we all have heard if you've been around the church for any number of days. If you just read the scriptures, you're going to see this idea of the husband as the head of his wife. The term headship has become synonymous with the term authority and describes man's position in distinction to woman. Two primary texts where you're going to have to wrestle through this term would be 1 Corinthians 11:3 and Ephesians 5:23. Let's start with 1 Corinthians 11:3. But I want you to understand that the head of every man is Christ, the head of a wife is her husband, and the head of Christ is God. You with me? Ephesians 5:23. How about that one? For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and he is himself its Savior. What do we know about this language of headship? Well, the question regarding the meaning of this word head here is one to which much ink has been spilt, and it's one that we cannot exhaustively pursue, understand, or unpack today. There's been volumes upon volumes written on it through the years, but I think there are a couple of things we need to be clear on when thinking through this all-important word headship as it regards male-female distinction. Let's talk about its distinction and then its description. When we think about authority and headship, what is the distinction that's being communicated in this word head? 1 Corinthians 11:3, but I want you to understand that the head of every man is Christ, the head of a wife is her husband, and the head of Christ is God. Well, if you want to understand that, it's best that we work backwards through that list. There are three distinctions being made here that need to be noted to understand the headship or authority being ascribed here. It is best to work backwards in the list to better express the distinctions being made. First, God is described as the head of Christ. You with me? Whatever we understand headship to be, we cannot describe it as addressing ontology. There's your big word for the day. Ontology, meaning any kind of substantive hierarchy in being. There's no hierarchy in being, a superiority in someone's being, ontology, in the term headship here. We cannot use terms like greater and lesser, stronger or weaker, superior or inferior when discussing the term head. We are all created in the image of God, and as such, we are ontologically equal. In our beings, equal. It does, however, express something of operation, something regarding operation and how we function distinctly in the plan and purpose of the unified Godhead. Though I am greatly simplifying the issue here for time's sake, I think it's best to describe the concept in terms of representation. Christ as the image of God, the firstborn over all creation, right? Christ, the image of God, firstborn over all creation, Colossians 1:15. He's the one who emptied himself of his heavenly identity, his heavenly rights, his heavenly privileges, Philippians 2:5 through 7. He became heaven's representative, its representation on earth, a representation of love and grace, of justice and mercy. As such, Christ is the head of man, his representative before the Father. And man is the representative of the woman to God, according to the text. As you can see, the authority gained in this headship is one of responsibility absorbed, representation shouldered. Responsibility absorbed, representation shouldered. Carrying the burden of the relationship, as it were. Christ carrying the burden of the relationship from the Father to His people. Husbands carrying the burden of the relationship of the marriage to the family dynamic. Christ carrying the burden of sin and everything broken in it to mankind. Carrying, absorbing, representing. The best way to understand that, though, is through the description that God gives of that. Ephesians 5:23, here's the description. We talked about the distinction, now the description. Ephesians 5:23, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, and is himself its Savior. The authority assumed, the representation shouldered in Ephesians 5:23 all the way to 33, verse 33, which we won't read, is one of giving ourselves wholly to the task of representing, absorbing, shouldering the needs of those who are under our care. It is one of sacrifice and service. And in so doing, it assumes a role of authority through love and respect, adoration and honor. That's how we see Christ model it. Far from being reduced to anything resembling language like the one who is in charge, or the one who makes the call, as reductionistic and unhelpful. The focus of the term describes the one who shoulders, absorbs the responsibility and lead in the care, the flourishing, and the joy of those under his care through sacrificial love and service. It simply cannot be reduced to who's in charge or who is first in the pecking order, even though there is clear operational authority and leadership. As the scriptures demonstrated, the term can simply not be communicated in terms of worldly analogy. When you want to begin explaining, now give me a picture of this, and we want to revert to worldly pictures, stop. Because here's the conflict of the world. Every time we want to find a worldly analogy or picture, every time we enter into that worldly analogy, what we're going to find is a conflict. Your desire will be contrary to him, and he will rule over you and oppress you because of the conflict of sin and our inability to understand, to engage, embrace the distinction. The world is at conflict over this issue, and Christ alone gives us a picture of it. There is no other analogy but Christ. Throw the rest of them to the wind. There is no other analogy. There is no other picture but Christ and him alone. So when we begin to understand these patterns, leadership, authority, as the scriptures explain them to us on biblical manhood, what are the principles? What are the principles that guide the way we begin to see that fleshed out? Let me offer you three texts, three scriptures with three principles to follow them. And understand again that these are to summarize, not to exhaustively speak to everything regarding biblical manhood. Summary fashion, three basic principles that drive, I believe, our understanding of biblical manhood. The first is servanthood. Biblical manhood can first be described under the term servanthood. Philippians 2, verses 3 through 8. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others, because you need to have this mind amongst yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God something to be grasped, but he emptied himself. By taking on the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself even to the point of death, even death on the cross. If headship is modeled first by Christ to his church and then directly through husbands to wives, then there is no better place to start than the principled place of servanthood. When the world and some conservative Christians want to begin describing manhood in terms of strength, courage, conviction, and these kind of underlying prescriptions like never let them see you sweat, never apologize, be a man, bow up, this kind of language, I think we need to push back and ask, what is this mind that is yours in Christ Jesus. To be certain, servanthood takes strength. It takes courage and conviction. However, it will often require men to sweat profusely, apologize often, and stand down for the sake of listening, hearing, and leading well. Courage and conviction in the pursuit of loving and serving is something our homes, the church, and the world definitely needs to see through biblical masculinity. There's a second principle I think we can draw from Christ, our only picture. It's one of sacrifice. A second principle of sacrifice. Servanthood, the first. Sacrifice, the second. Ephesians 5:25. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. What does that tell us about headship? If this is the description that follows the call in verse 23 to husbands are heads of the wives, what is the description of it? Well, 25 says to love them as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Jesus did not count equality with God something to be grasped, but he emptied himself. As creator, he emptied himself of the right to punish ungrateful sinners who worshiped and served the creation rather than the creator. He had every right. He gave up that. As the second person of the Trinity, he gave up the comforts of glory in heaven. As God in flesh, he gave up position and power and prestige, constantly turning away from every moment that they wanted to exalt him as king. While he walked the earth, he moved away from those things, giving up position, power, and prestige. He absorbed the ridicule, shame, injustice, and immediate vindication that he could have had at any point in time for the greater goal to which he was called. Hebrews 12:2 reminds us, calls us to look to Jesus, the founder, the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. He despised its shame. Whatever shame would be hurled at him, whatever ridicule would be pushed upon him because how he was not fulfilling all of the things that should have been by way of kingship and authority and good teacher dynamics. He despised that shame, so that he would pay the necessary price for purchasing you and me. And he sits exalted at the right hand of God the Father because of that shame the world would hurl at him for it. As men, we are called to the same sacrifice with our goal set on the same higher calling of absorbing sin to pursue the greater goal of righteousness. However, we do so as sinners. Different from Jesus, we do so as sinners, constantly fighting the temptation to assert our authority, to flex our superior strength, and to put the woman in her place. Genesis tells us that's going to be the problem for the rest of our lives. It's something that wells up every day as we struggle with the calling of considering more others more significant than ourselves. Sacrifice is what it calls on us as we look to Christ as our heavenly example. The last point, principle that guides biblical manhood is submission. It worked because it was a third S, right? Just happened to also work. I'm just kidding. Submission. All right, Josh, look, I'm tracking with you. I'm following with you. But look, that word, that word is specifically reserved for women. It's very clear in the Bible, women submit. So why are you calling men out on that one? Let me just offer you a couple of thoughts on that. I said one scripture for per point, but I'm going to give you two on this one. Colossians 2:6-7. Therefore, as you received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk in him, rooted and built up in him and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. As you receive the Lord Jesus Christ, so walk in him. Let's flesh that out. Ephesians 5:1-2, therefore be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love as Christ loved and loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Verse 20 and 21, giving thanks always and for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. That in Christ, We submit ourselves to Him, which means we're submitting ourselves to one another in all things. Because if we believe what Colossians is saying, if we believe what Ephesians is saying, then we pair that up against Philippians 2, have this mind in you, which is yours in Christ Jesus, and we understand that our manhood is first represented in the way we submit ourselves to Christ. If we were asking women to submit to the leadership of men, which we will outline next week, then it would serve us well to model that in the way we submit ourselves to the Lord Jesus Christ. If we are asking women to accept the God-given authority ascribed to men, then we must submit ourselves to the loving, gracious authority of our Savior through dependency, love, and devotion to Him in all things and all that we do, all that we are. Principally, if you want to understand what it means to be a man, love Christ before a watching world in all things. Which leads us lastly to practices. If these are patterns and principles that drive what we are, how do you flesh this out, Josh? Let's get practical, man, right? Well, we could dive off into 1,000 particulars, but for time's sake, I'm going to still continue to paint with some broad strokes of application. I think there's three things that maybe we could glean from what we're saying this morning as we look to Christ, our manliest example, if we can say so. The first is this simple principle: love well. Love well. Let me break that down to the various kind of places in which He calls us as men to love well, as leaders. Those of y'all who are in position of leadership in your workplaces, in your community environments, in whatever context He calls you to lead, in your marriages, in your home, with your children, whatever it is, as leaders, let me encourage you how we practice this idea set forth in these patterns and principles. Leaders, pursue the thoughts, the insights, the contributions, and the gifts of the women in your life. Lead well by including well, benefiting from and valuing and honoring the different voices of your people, men and women, young and old, rich and poor alike. Value the voices of all people, considering others more significant than yourself. Everybody has a contribution. Everybody needs to show you how they can contribute their voice. Love well, 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 7. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not envy, it doesn't boast, it's not arrogant or rude. It doesn't insist on its own way, it's not irritable and resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, it believes all things, it hopes all things, it endures all things. A lot of things that I thought through this week, all the points and principles and ways of communicating things, and it was simply 1 Corinthians 13 that wreaked havoc on my life this week. I'm irritable. I'm tired. I'm frustrated. I'm taking it out on people. My family's told me. My family's told me they see it. My daughters have communicated they see it. I know I've demonstrated on staff. And so I can get up tomorrow, I can strap on my bootstrap, put on my big boy pants, and say, I'm going to love well today. And I will fail again. Or I can look to Jesus. I can marvel at, pour into the scriptures that remind me of His love. I can be reminded of what it means that it was for the joy set before Him that He endured the cross for me. It was me on His mind when He endured all the shame of the cross. I can be reminded again that His daily ambition is to sit at the Father's right hand and speak for me. And then I can think about the level of patience that takes for me. And I can find my way back to a place of manly love for my people. I didn't get past 1 Corinthians 13 this week, just so you know. But for your sake, Lord kept making me make notes. So here it comes. Husbands, how do we see this loving will demonstrated to husbands? Well, pursue your wives relentlessly as Christ pursues you. Step out of your position and do not wait for, bellyache over, or expect your wife's initiation. Christ is the initiator of our faith and relationship, and he tells us to love our wives as Christ loved the church and takes the initiative with her. He didn't wait for you to come to him. He came to you. In love and grace, husbands, pursue your wives. Fathers, pursue your children as Christ pursues you. Exalt Christ in your own life and in your home. Take the initiative in cultivating a home where devotions are regular, spiritual discussions are common. Talk to your children about their faith and yours. Repent to your children. Sing and worship in front of your children and call your children to faith. That's loving them well. Men in general, single, married, young and old, rich and poor, be an example. As one who considers others more significant than yourself. Be an example of that with men, with women, with rich, with poor, with quiet people and loud people. With young, with old, with intelligent and with simple people. Demonstrate the reality that you consider them more significant than yourself. Demonstrate to all people a character of love, of joy, of peace, of patience, of kindness, of goodness, of faithfulness, of gentleness, of self-control. Because Paul tells us that is the fruit of his Spirit in us. First, practice is love well. Second, practice, work hard. Through the years, I've heard a multitude of sermons or talks on the right expression of submission and authority in the home. In those talks, I've heard things like a good wife is one who waits at the door for her husband to return home from work with a plate of nachos and an invitation to sit in the living room and watch the game while she finishes up supper. Not in my home. I've heard the detailed description of how to rebuke a wife for not doing the dishes. Granted, the example given called for men to take the brunt of the responsibility for not leading well and compelling her to do the dishes well enough. But the ultimate conclusion was if she continues to fail or to rebel in doing the dishes, the elders should be brought in to deal with it. It's in a book. I can give it to you. It's in my library. I should burn it, but it's still there. There are countless examples of how a husband should be treated as the king of his domain and allowed to come into a place of rest and refreshing. The home is a place where they need to come home to rest and refreshing, and the woman should make it so. To all of those writers, I say, show me. Give me a text. Show me a place where you can adulterate the truth to that end. Where in the scriptures can you even adulterate it to say something as nonsensical as that? Here's what the Bible does call us to and promise us regarding the masculine call to work. It's going to be hard. Sweat of your brow, thorns and thistles. When you get home every day from work, who is the one who's off the clock? Just answer that one for me. Who's off the clock when you get home from work every day? When are you off the clock, husband, father, man? When you look at the life of Christ, you find a man who labored tirelessly unto the Lord in thorns and in thistles by the sweat of his brow every time he tried to break away, as he was known to do, to pray and to seek the Lord. They find him. That was the only thing he ever broke away to do, and he was just wanting to pray and spend time in devotion to the Lord. They found him there, and what was his response to them? Nothing but love and service. The life of Paul was no different. He labored exhaustively for the sake of the people of God, enduring all kinds of hardship and persecution. There is no rest for the weary in this life. The Lord gives us Sabbath to find rest, and we should take time away once a week to do that very thing, to find our rest in Him. We should take regular times of vacation, of rest and recuperation. Yes, I'm not saying rest is bad, but I'm telling you, when you walk through the doors of your home, you are not off the clock, men. You know why? Because nobody is. We all engage the home. You're not the only one who's been working all day. Practically, I've told many husbands in counseling that the best thing they can do every day is to pray on the way to work, for the Lord to help you labor well and faithfully before a watching world, and to pray on the way home every day that you might engage your family well as you enter back into the home to fulfill your God-given role there. On the way to work, on the way home from work. Lastly, I would say this under work hard. Young men and single men, here's my encouragement to you. Work hard while you have fewer distractions. Maybe less than 6 kids. Throw your gaming systems in the trash and every other thing that zaps your time and keeps you from fulfilling your God-given calling to work hard. Throw that crap in the garbage. Find a ministry to put your back into and places to serve where you can exercise your gifts, initiate the work of ministry in life, and stop waiting on it to come to you. Older saints, retirement is what funerals are for and why we look to the horizon and pray, "Come, Lord Jesus." I'm not saying that you can't finish one chapter of your life at a particular workplace. If you've been responsible enough with your finances and worked hard and long enough in a place where that offers you retirement so that you can move on, what a blessing. Take it. Just think of all the ministry you now have to offer the church and the work of God in this most important season of your life. Please, on the authority of Scripture, don't waste your best years of life in ministry wasting away on lesser joys than those that we will receive when He calls us home and we truly enter His rest, His retirement. Don't give up the best days of your life. We need your counsel, wisdom, and experience now more than ever. Love well, work hard, lastly, be strong. Be strong. And this is quick. The Bible is full of calls to be strong and courageous. Though I do not believe this to be a primarily masculine charge, I do think we need to hear the call to be strong, particularly as men. You might have in the back of your mind that what America needs most right now is strong, non-effeminate warrior poets as men, right? That was a Braveheart quote in case you missed it. That's going to bring our churches back to where it needs to be. That's what's going to bring our country back to where it needs to be. Strong, non-effeminate warrior poets. Funny, I would say that men, godly men, need a strong male and female presence of strength in their lives so that they can begin to understand what strength looks like. What it means. God has created man in the image of God, male and female, them, so that as them, they can communicate godly image bearing as husbands and wives, mothers and fathers into their children, so that godly young men can become godly men at the voice of mom and dad. And so maybe we should quit using terms that dehumanize mothers and sisters and wives and women in general, like don't let them be effeminate, as derogatory statements that we don't recognize actually speak against women, and begin asking and understanding what are the roles that we all contribute to the community of God, and understanding that there are godly expressions of manhood and godly expressions of womanhood, and they both feed and fuel a next generation of godly manhood and womanhood. We value the unity of what Christ communicates as one flesh union. Strength is demonstrated first, I believe, in our vigorous pursuit of Christ, who pushed against all the cultural norms that drive the narrative of our church and culture around us. That we should vigorously pursue Christ in our diligence, in our pursuit of the hard work of the calling that He set before us as distinctly, yes, men. We will be fit for our, if we do this, if we understand the love of Christ demonstrated for us, if we set the example of Christ before us in servanthood and sacrifice and submission unto Him and then to one another, then we actually will be fit to fight the greatest foe, to fight our hardest war, which is an unseen world that is militating against this view in our hearts that wants us to stand up and have to accept all kinds of worldly notions rather than biblical expressions of godly manhood and womanhood. The pattern that he sets before us is one of leadership and authority, a leadership and authority that is marked by servanthood and sacrifice and submission first to the Lord, then to one another. It's demonstrated in the way we love well, we work hard, and we stand up strong and courageous as followers of Christ into this world. May God grant us the grace to demonstrate that well. Let's pray together. Father, we love you. We're grateful for your grace to us in the Lord Jesus. We're grateful for the language that you give us in Scripture. It doesn't set one group of people over another, one gender over another, one person over another, male, female, rich, poor. Strong and weak, young and old, but you communicate all manner of expressions or operations in which older serve the younger and rich help, love, and care for the poor, and men provide leadership and authority in society and home, women provide strength and encouragement and undergirding. Lord, you give us operation in so many distinctive ways, But as you set forth for us the chief example as one who did not consider equality with God something to be held onto, but you emptied yourself, you call us to empty ourselves and to follow Christ as our chief authority. Where my words have fallen short and where cultural triggers have confused the language that you would have us understand today, would your Spirit speak truth through our hearts? Would you lift high the Lord Jesus in our lives? Would you exalt Christ in our hearts? And would you set before us a chief expression and example of his strength, his love, his diligence, his servanthood, his sacrifice, Lord, his submission to the Father, as those things that mark the way we want to live our lives. Grant us the grace to apply those things well, to think about those things well in the context of our homes, our workplace, our community, our culture, our world, and the kingdom that you've called us to labor in. And all for the glory of your name, we pray it for Christ's sake. Amen. Would you stand? Let's respond to God in worship.
That man is blessed who fearing God from sin restrains his feet. Who will not stand with wicked men, who shuns the scorner's seat. Yea, blessed is he who makes God's law his portion and delight, and meditates upon that law with gladness day and night. He shall be nourished like a tree near planted by a stream, which in his season yields his fruit, his leaf is always green. And all he does shall prosper well, his work shall ever stand. But wicked men like driven chaff are swept from off the land. When judgment comes, they shall not stand, who walk ungodly ways. Nor in the assembly of the just shall wicked men remain. The Lord will guard the righteous well, their way to him is known. The way of sinners far from God shall surely be your throne.
I sit there listening to the song and the words of the song and thinking about what was just said, you always think about those things which stand out or that cause confusion. And I'm sitting there thinking about the last thing that I said. I don't think it was entirely clear, and I want to make sure I do clarify it a little bit. This language of what we think we need is strong, non-effeminate warrior poets, and what I was saying in that is, I think in the dynamic of trying to raise up godly men, we want to be careful not to suppress that which is actually communicating strength to them. We're going to talk next week about the Proverbs 31 woman, and if you read the language of that, you understand that the heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain from her. Her children rise up and call her blessed. So when I look up and go, don't be an effeminate male, as if that's a derogatory term to be able to draw from and learn from that primary voice in your life. I just want to make clarity on that. What I'm trying to guard us from and what I'm saying there at the end is when we begin to talk about what it means to be strong, masculine warrior poets and all of those things, is that we need to be careful not to reduce the matter down into simple things. There are things that we didn't talk about today. There are physiological dynamics and there are practical expressions that we did not get to today that we can talk about and have conversations about and need to as we go forward about what is this role and its distinction and the way it plays out in the church. But we need to begin that discussion first through the lens of Christ who leads us well in the way he defines those terms for us. And so if you have questions, thoughts, ways that you want to think through the expression of that, if you're looking up going, hey, so what does that look like in the church? Where do you stand on this? Do you think it's bad if she has nachos waiting on you when you get home? No, if you've been giving nachos to your husband on the way home, thank you for your service to them. If he expects it, shame on him. Right? All right. Receive the Lord's blessing, his benediction as we go this morning. From 1 Thessalonians 3, 12 through 13, may the Lord make you increase and abound in love for one another and for all, as we do for you, so that he may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all the saints. So go in his peace today.